Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
The Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update. My name is Yvonne Stroman and I will serve as your host for the program. The Council on Chemical Abuse is Berks County's drug and alcohol premier center. We are responsible for the planning, administration, and implementation as it relates to prevention, recovery, intervention, and treatment services. We provide these services to Berks County so that individuals have the best chance of getting well. Our phone number is 610-376-8669, and we invite you to visit our website at www.cocaberks.org. So as we talk about alcohol and drug abuse, we know that it takes a major toll on the human body. Recovering from these substances is a gradual process. Nutrition on many levels requires attention, specifically during drug and alcohol use. And sometimes it does get neglected because individuals are spending a significant amount of time acquiring and using substances. And so proper nutrition oftentimes takes a back seat. But we know that nutrition is a formidable part of our livelihood. And so when individuals enter into the realm of recovery from using substances, nutrition and the value of nutrition is important at that time so that they can grow and prosper in a healthy and physical manner. So about the next 25 minutes, we're going to be having a conversation about the wealth and advantages of proper nutrition, particularly in early recovery. And I couldn't do that conversation on my own because I do need a little help. And with me to do that this afternoon is a friend of mine, Kim Kulp. Kim is a volunteer at the Berks Rise Center. She provides with her own time and valuable expertise information about nutrition, not only just nutrition, but good nutrition, and how it can be really pivotal for somebody that is getting well to have information and knowledge about the importance of nutrition and how that can contribute to someone's well-being. So, Kim, how are you today?
Thank you, Yvonne. I'm well. Thank you.
Good. So I want to just kind of say thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and joining me to talk about an important topic that I think oftentimes, and you can, I would ask for your feedback on this, but nutrition is something that kind of gets put by the wayside, even during now with COVID-19 and social distancing. And, you know, when you're talking about just kind of raising awareness, nutrition kind of just, we take it for granted, I think. And so I just kind of want to get your take on, if you wouldn't mind, giving us your insight based on your expertise about society. And when I say society, I'm talking about we as Americans in particular, our relationship with food in general, with food and then looking at food and nutrition. And what would you say, is it fairly good? Do we need some growth in that area? How would you respond to that?
Well, unfortunately, yes. For America, there is a wide chasm, if you will, in our viewpoint as Americans regarding food. And some of that chasm really has a lot to do with the socio-net and economic status that in some communities, and especially from what I've observed in the recovery community, there's a lack of knowledge, not a lack of understanding, and there is an unknown, there's anxiety over it. Some people, there are groups that have a history within their own family group of not having supportive food mentors, which, you know, unfortunately, we as human beings and as Americans, you know, we crave comfort, and food is a great comfort. And that can lead to obsession when it comes to the food, and almost in both ways of over and under when it comes to how we view food. Some people in some families are extremely overabundant with both what they prepare and how they prepare it, and the amounts that they prepare. And others may have a very restricted or restrictive look at food, very minimal. So in America, we see such a disparity in how we view food, and it can be a very large source of anxiety on a day-to-day basis for a lot of people. Even if we look at somebody on the outside and say, hey, they are, you know, they look healthy, what they're eating on a daily basis, you might be surprised at how ineffective their nutrition is, that they take in. So it's a very big issue for all of us to take care of, and especially those that are participating in recovery programs.
Yeah, and really, would you say that nutrition really can contribute to not only problems, but it also can maybe get in the way of somebody really, because it's not a topic that we readily talk about, right? What we know is that, you know, we are growing up that when we're hungry, we eat, and we just kind of, you know, maybe would grab for anything. And so I guess my thought is, and I wanted you to contribute to this thought, is that food can even be a trigger, because you talked about that a little bit in terms of just our emotionality. But the importance of raising awareness around that could be really, really instrumental, because it's part of our, you know, when we talk about early recovery, one of the things they encourage us to do is say, be able to identify your triggers, right? And so we talk about, when we talk about people, places, and things, we usually land on, you know, people, like the people that we hang around, or the places that we go, or the things. Oftentimes I might hear people say that, you know, a certain area or certain music or a certain smell, right? And we don't necessarily mention anything about food, but food can be a trigger. Oh, and particularly certain foods like sweets and that type of thing. Would you mind commenting on that?
Well, there's an acronym in the recovery community: hungry, angry, lonely, tired. Mm-hmm. So hunger is mentioned for a very specific reason. If we are in a deficit, whether it's actual quantity of food we're taking in or the nutritional value of that food, it can throw our bodies off balance. And we're not just talking about only the physical being of our body, but we're also talking about the emotional and mental well-being of our body. So when we are not sufficiently giving our bodies the opportunity to be nourished fully, we are in a deficit, and that can lead to a relapse. And you mentioned smell. You know, some people do, they may have aversions to certain smells that will be associated with food. You know, sometimes as a child, depending on our household, we may have been forced to eat certain foods that now repulse us, that might actually be healthy, but because of that emotional connection, it can create anxiety and depression and all of those feelings that, again, out of balance, can throw us into that spiral of relapse. And, you know, I know that I've come in contact with people that have had long periods of time in homelessness. Mm-hmm. And often the idea of food is a much different concept for them than people who have always lived in abundance. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of different ways that this needs to be addressed in this community specifically, but as a nation as well.
Okay. Yeah. And so how could we encourage others to begin to have that conversation? Because I think sometimes even in my circle, when we talk about food, we associated then, Kim, with, so what are you saying? Are you saying I'm fat? Or are you saying I'm skinny? You know what I mean? Sure. And it's like, it's not any of those things. As much as we talk about, you know, portions, and then we hear from, you know, the Food and Drug Administration about, we get into, you know, body mass index, and we get into, you know, why it's important that we grow our own food. And, you know, what I find oftentimes is when I go to the farmer's market, you know, sometimes those healthier foods could be a little bit more expensive for folks who kind of just will throw their hands up because I can't afford that. And so, but I believe, and I know you and I have had conversations about this, that there are ways that we can be healthy in our food selections and not necessarily have to break the bank. So, you know, how could you respond to somebody? How can we, you know, in terms of being educators, allow for that conversation to become natural and to become one that is from a place of care, not necessarily that the person feels now, you know, I'm defended and I have to defend? Because, you know, sometimes food can be a very big, it could be a wonderful conversation, but it also can be a detriment. Would you agree?
Yes, very much. And the first is, if the individual actually is looking and willing to take some information in, that's always, if you know, I've learned that I don't offer my advice, especially when it comes to food, unless I'm asked.
Okay.
You know, and yet it is, it's a very important subject, but some people, you know, again, background, history, all of that stuff can really affect how they emotionally are connected to food. So it is difficult, but there's no way to correlate somebody's body size with how healthy they are in most general terms.
Mm-hmm.
There are many people who are what we would look at as athletically built bodies that are maybe on the lower end of that body mass index, and yet they may not be healthy. They may be extremely unhealthy. It's just, that's their body. And we can go the completely different way with that to somebody who we would think has some kind of possible issue with weight, and they may be extremely healthy. So the judgment isn't the size, it's what they're taking in. And hopefully, if they're willing to have that talk, and you're right, the cost always has that scare factor to it. Oh, well, if I'm going to eat healthy, it means it's going to cost me more. Well, there are ways, even to just take one meal a day and eat something completely healthy and nutritional, whether that's an apple and some carrot sticks and maybe a little bit of peanut butter, those things don't cost a lot.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to McDonald's or you go to any of these fast food restaurants, if you get a burger, a fry, and a soda, you're at between $6 and $7.
Mm-hmm.
You can definitely have some carrot sticks, apple slices, even a potato, a baked potato, for far less for one meal. And that's a very nutritious meal. It does not take a gargantuan amount of money in order to eat healthy, but we do have that sense about it.
Yeah.
Now, over time, what happens, or what I have found, is that when you eat healthier, your body stops craving some of that other stuff that actually just throw away food, because you might be spending only $1 on a bag of chips and thinking that that's sufficient enough to fill you up.
Right.
But what you're doing is you're creating a deficit within your body. And it may not happen immediately, but over time, that deficit continues to grow. Whereas putting fresh vegetables or fruits into your body over time strengthens our body. It becomes that asset. So spending $1 on a bag of fries versus $1 on an apple and some carrot sticks and maybe a baked potato, because all of those three things together could cost you $1.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a big difference. And it doesn't, what I try to stress is, this is not a wholesale change all at once. This is implementing small things on a daily, weekly schedule that eventually you feel better just by doing it. Your body will respond in a very positive way when you give it that proper nutrition. And it doesn't take long, but it does take time.
Yeah.
And if that is where I ask people to allow somebody to help them, whoever that might be, whether it's through the budget, whether going into the grocery store, whether just even talking about what they do or don't like. Some people have an aversion to green. and I understand that. So there's just those little things, but it does not take a lot of money to start to eat healthy.
How about, what is your insight about having a conversation with your doctor? Sometimes they say, you know, when you're going to the doctor and they're, you know, doing your weight and that type of thing, you know, conferring with your doctor, consulting with your doctor, much like we do, you know, we consult with a dentist when our teeth are hurting, we consult with the eye doctor. You know, when we have a general physician that is checking us and we're, you know, we might go into the doctor because we're going to work. And now we, you know, we're getting a new job and we need to go see our doctor to pass that physical test. Part of that can be a conversation about perhaps what foods we're eating and how we're eating. Sometimes people can get by with three meals a day versus somebody that gets by with two. So I think, you know, the FDA standards sometimes that we have, that we might see on TV or on a poster, doesn't necessarily mean one size fits all. Would you agree?
Oh, very much. And as always, I do suggest that, especially for anybody who has a pre-existing condition of any sort, that they do consult with their doctor. However, in general, it is also helpful. They have a lot of information they can pass along. So they definitely can be a good starting point. And there are many resources online as well to help out with that type of an idea of where do I start?
Mm-hmm.
And it is, it's not a difficult proposition to start, but it's a willingness to continue that I also find can be a little bit of a hindrance when this type of a subject comes up. When it comes to food, people have that, well, if it's not going to give me immediate satisfaction, you know, I might choose to not do it right away.
right. And you and your, and as we talk about this, there's a nice parallel in terms of when we talk about recovery and we talk about investing in our overall well-being, because really it's a process. When we have made that commitment to, and I shared with somebody earlier, it's easy to stop. It's the staying stop, right?
Mm-hmm.
That the process can be endearing in the way of finding out who we are and finding out, you know, how our lives can really bloom and flourish in a way that really does give ourselves the time that we can to allow ourselves to grow in that manner. And it's no different. I appreciate your comment about, you know, maybe taking it a meal at a time and understanding, I think it's important to understand that maybe there's going to be moments that we're not going to do it right all the way. You know, so we wake up in the morning with a commitment to egg whites and a piece of toast without butter. It doesn't mean that if we go back the next day to one of my favorite things, croissant, right? That we're failures. And I think those messages sometimes we incorporate about, you know, we didn't do something right. You know, that it's progress and not perfection. Would you say?
Oh, for sure. And, you know, myself, I do not eat perfectly every day. I know that I should eat a certain amount of very good, healthy, whole food in my diet on a regular basis. Some days, that's not going to happen. Whatever comes into play may change my plans, but I have a plan nonetheless.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the idea behind the classes that I offer, is to have a plan. Whether or not you can stick to it 100% all the time, that's going to be impossible for anybody, especially starting out. But the idea is to identify where you can make some small changes over time that will improve your life, your intake, your nutrition base, so that you feel better, so that your body responds. It's not on all or nothing. And we are, as in our community, we know it's all or nothing a lot of times for us. And just as human beings, we can have that mentality. So I always encourage, you know, one small area at a time. Some people don't even know what they do or don't like for certain fruits and vegetables. Mm-hmm. They've never had them. And I always suggest buy one, try it out, whatever that one thing is. Give yourself a chance to try it. You may or may not like it. That's okay. You know?
Yeah. And I appreciate the conversation about food and about recovery, because I know for myself, when I was in early recovery, you know, understanding that sometimes food takes the place of using drugs. When you're using, it takes up a quite amount of time, and you don't really realize that until you're in recovery. And then when you're going to something that you consider yourself to be safe, and, you know, we go to outings, we go out to breakfast, that's what we do. We meet with our support group, and we go to the diner, and we grab a sandwich and that type of thing. But the mindset of being mindful about perhaps why are we choosing to have this donut right now, or why are we choosing to have these bag of chips, and that void that we feel. You know, sometimes it's uncovered for us that, you know, we're trying to fill something, we're trying to fill a void. But having that understanding can really be instrumental in changing our course in terms of what we think about food and how we think about it.
Most definitely. Yeah. There, like, again, that whole emotional component to food. When you're in recovery, especially early on, all of a sudden you may recognize you have a lot more money than you ever had before. And now you can have as much food as you want, kind of thing. That can also be a part of it. But again, like you mentioned, mindfulness, having a plan, being ready to make some changes and accept options at times is the best successful way, I believe, at looking at nutrition.
Yeah, and we have about 3 or 4 minutes left, but I just kind of want to mention in terms of get your insight in the way of those that may be a little deficient, because we also know, right, that with nutrition comes the opportunity for certain, you know, the vitamin D's and the vitamin B's and the vitamin C's and all that other good stuff. And so how, if we are food deficient, that it can be, you know, internally we don't see it, but there can be some damage that is occurring internally for us when we're not choosing to take care of ourselves in that manner as well. Because I've seen that too in early recovery in terms of folks, they're so concerned about weight gain that they do the total opposite.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Yes.
And that is, I've seen that as well in women that I've mentored. And, you know, the restrictive, the overly restrictive, the idea of a diet can be extremely dangerous. Again, a doctor may need to be involved with that. A counselor may need to be involved with that. Because that can be a very big issue and concern. And it is one of those things. Our bodies, if we can think about that, our body is a machine. And just like any other machine, what you put into it is what it's going to be able to put out. So if you aren't putting any good quality foods into that, your energy level, you're going to be eating on your own body reserves for a period of time that is going to eventually wear your body down. Those little cogs, so to speak, in our knees and you know, all our little joints and our internal systems work, all are affected, and that builds up over time. If we're in a deficit situation for a prolonged period of time, it generally does have some somewhat devastating effects on our body.
That can be irreversible, Kim.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's important, I think, you know, in terms of our own wellness, and we're talking about mentally, physically, spiritually, and the physical piece of that, right? The physical piece of that is very, very instrumental in terms of its movement. Now, if we're feeling good, oftentimes we, you know, we have a positive outlook and our thinking becomes a little bit clearer, versus if there are deficiencies along the way, then it kind of clouds the outlook. And then the actions become probably self-defeating for ourselves.
Very much, yes. And there's a whole biology that goes along with when we do something positive for our body responds positively.
And you say that again, because I really like that.
Well, when you take in positive food, thoughts, feelings, your body responds in a positive way.
I'm going to say it shows up. I mean, I think it shows up with clear skin. Oh. It shows up with, you know, fingernails are growing and all those positive things that come about. Well, thank you. We were just given the 60-second sign, so I just want to quickly remind those that are watching today that the Council on Chemical Abuse is Berks County's Drug and Alcohol Premier Center, 610-376-8669. See us on the website at www.cocaberks.org. Kim, thank you so much for joining me today and for your expertise. I'm hoping that as we move forward and we go from phase yellow to phase green, we can begin to have a conversation about having you come back into the Berks Rise Center and deliver this information in person. But I really do appreciate you, appreciate who you are and what you bring to the wealthness of our community in the name of recovery. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And we want to wish everyone else to please be safe. Please practice social distancing, and please be well. God bless everyone. Again, thank you, Kim, and we're going to say goodbye.
Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.